بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم أما بعد. My dear brothers and sisters, it's that time of the year where a lot of people are going to be performing Udhiyya, Qurbani, we say in the Urdu language, an act of ibadah which is, mashallah, established from the time of Ibrahim alayhi salam onwards. Now, I don't want to go into the history of this particular segment or what I want to talk about. Not so much the history of why we do it, what's the rationale behind it and so on, but rather talk about some fiqhi jurisprudence, some rules and regulations, and perhaps clear the air in regards to a couple of issues. Udhiyya or Qurbani is an act of worship within the days of Eid al-Adha and some days thereafter, where an animal is slaughtered and meat is eaten and also distributed and given to the poor. The basis for this action we find in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as well as the ayat of Quran. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala mentions, "Inna a'atainaka al-kawthar fasalli li rabbika wanhar." From this second ayah of chapter number 108, ulama deduced that the nahar, the qurbani, is something which is essential and something which is important. Fasalli li rabbika, therefore turn to your Lord in prayer, wanhar, and sacrifice. Other than Surah Kawthar, there is also another particular hadith narrated on the authority of Jabir radiallahu anhu, found in the Sunan of Imam Abu Dawood, hadith number 2810, where he radiallahu anhu mentions that he prayed Eid Salah with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Thereafter Salah, two rams were brought and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam slaughtered them. And he mentioned, Bismillahi Allahu Akbar, Hatha anni wa an lam yudahhi min ummati. These two rams are on my behalf and behalf of my those ummah which could not slaughter or did not slaughter. Didn't do it, the question may arise, didn't do it because they didn't have the funds or they chose not to do it. And it's on that basis where you have two different groups of ulama. Some are of the opinion that no, it's wajib, it's necessary and it's mandatory upon those who can afford it. And you have those that say no, so long as one person does it, khalas, it's done. We have to be just when we say that some ulama do say it, Sunnah al-Mu'akkadah. Some of the great jurists of the Ummah, Imam Shafi'i, Imam Malik, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, according to one of his narrations, and others as well. And on the other side, you have the likes of Imam Awza'i, Layth ibn Sa'ad, Imam Abu Hanifa, Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, and also one of the opinions of Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, that is necessary. So the former, they say, no, it's a Sunnah al-Mu'akkadah, it's a Sunnah emphasized, it's encouraged. But the others say that no, rather it's a wajib and something which is necessary. And again, what it is that the reasoning behind those ulama that say is necessary is they say, if you look at the wording of the Quran, Surah Al-Kawthar, verse number 2, it mentions wanhar and slaughter. That is an imperative action, that's a command. And therefore a command is something which you must carry out, it's something which is not optional. And then obviously the other ulama, they have their evidences and their reasoning as well. But there's another particular hadith as well, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentioned, and this hadith can be found in Ahmad and Ibn Majah, where he mentioned, whoever can afford to sacrifice but does not do so, then that person should not approach our place of prayer. That person who has the means to do so, who can afford to offer a sacrifice and doesn't choose to do so, then that person should not approach our place of prayer. Now this again is another evidence in favor of those ulama that say the no, it's necessary, something which we should do. There is a common misunderstanding within the ummah, and we want to just clarify this as well. Ata ibn Yasar rahimahullah, he mentions, I asked Abu Ayyub al-Ansari radiallahu anhu, a sahabi, and he said, how was the sacrifice done in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? And he radiallahu anhu, he mentions that a man would offer a slaughter on his behalf and on behalf of his household. They would eat, feed some of the meat, feed the people from there as well. And until the people, meaning the later people, would boast about it, and it's become as you see it now. Again, this hadith is mentioned in Imam Tirmidhi 1505. It's an authentic hadith as well. So one may get implied by this that, hold on, if a man slaughtered on behalf of himself and his family, is therefore not necessary for the family members. Now, again, I go back to that other hadith. The hadith I mentioned, which was in favor of those scholars that said it's wajib and necessary. Because they said, the hadith mentioned that whosoever has the ability, whosoever has the means to sacrifice, and yet they choose not to do so. Whoever can afford and does not sacrifice. Because of what we say in Arabic, the word is umum. It's so general. Whoever possesses the ability, whoever can afford. So that whoever, included in that, are women, men, and also so on. Keeping in mind that those who are not mature, those who are not baligh, those who are not of the understanding, it's not incumbent upon them. Where they mention that someone slaughtered on behalf of his family, the answer those ulama give to this particular hadith is that those though those individuals that did this particular act were doing so because it was not incumbent upon their wives, it was not incumbent upon their baligh children, it was not incumbent upon any other person. Hence, when they slaughtered, it was sufficient on behalf of themselves and nobody else was necessary. And also another issue as well is that being male is not an obligation. If a woman, for example, now didn't have a husband, for example, she was separated, perhaps divorced, perhaps she was widowed, and she had enough money, would we then say that it's not necessary upon her? And the answer given to that is no, it would be necessary upon her. And for that reason, this is why the hadith which I just quoted was Imam Tirmidhi, rahimahullah, 1505. The answer given to that particular hadith is that that was referring to people who had the means, but yet the women in the household and the children, whoever, or the other occupants, did not have the means to do so. I was watching this thing once, and subhanAllah, it was interesting. Someone made this comment, and it seems quite logical. It seems quite logical. The object was, why don't we 1 year, don't do no Qurbani and Udhiyya at all, gather all the money we spend and give that to the poor? But the thing is like this, remember one thing, our iman, let's look at this, let's decipher this, let's break this thing down. Firstly, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he himself carried out actions which were most befitting for the ummah. At times we may not understand the rationale and the wisdom, but he also could have done the same. He mentioned all the time he was in Medina, he did Udhiyya every single year. And as I mentioned, he did two rams and so on. There's hadith there. This thought didn't come in the mind of the Prophet ﷺ that I could just give money to the poor. I could encourage the Sahaba that gather your money and let's give it all to a poor person, poor persons, people, and so on. But rather he opted to make a sacrifice and an udhiyya. And a non-obligatory one as well. Because only one was mandatory, one sheep. But he gave another one as well, a non-obligatory. So why would he choose to do that? And that's the answer we give to those individuals. Firstly, deen and religion is not based on aql and intelligence. This is just a general answer, and I'll come to the other parts in a second. Secondly, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he himself practiced upon this. Now, whether you say it's wajib or a prophetic sunnah, bottom line is he did it, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Number three, if we were to start using this rationale, well, why don't we use the same rationale for Hajj? And say, well, hold on a sec, man's are spending in excess of 5-6k to go Hajj. I know people from Crawley last year, approximately 20 people went. So if you calculate the money that cost 20 people, that's near enough 100 grand. And the person who asked this question happened to be from Pakistan. So you're saying that just from Crawley alone, you've got 2 crore rupees or 2.5 crore rupees, which is quite a significant amount of money. So the akal and intelligence think, well, hold on a second, allow Hajj. Why don't you just send all your money there? Acts of worship are established and we follow those particular acts of worship exactly how the Prophet ﷺ done them. You see, what it is that a Muslim has to develop this mindset that whatever I've got, inna salati wa nusuki wa mahyaya wa mamati lillahi rabbil alameen, that my praying, my sacrifice, my living and my dying is solely and only for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the philosophy we need to build. Everything of mine, whatever I have, is all for the service of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. That's what we're trying to inculcate within ourselves, our families, our communities, and the people. Every Muslim should have this desire, this jazbah, this want, this passion. Everything of mine is for the deen. And when I have a choice between deen or the dunya, I will always give preference to the things of deen. The person who asked, said, who made this objection, I'm not saying no one else in the world did, but the geezer who did, he happened to be from Pakistan. Let me ask you a question, my brother. Why not take the money the people spend on Basant, the kite flying tradition, take the money which people spend on Mendis and Mujras and these particular things, take that money 1 year and give that to the poor? Why have you only got to look at the things of Deen? Why have people only got to look at the things of Islam? Can any Hajj, we shouldn't do Hajj, give money? Oh, Bhai Saab, how about the Yomir, what's it called, this 14th of August? How much money, millions and millions and crore rupees get spent for that? Why not take that money and give it to the poor? Why only look at the things of Islam? Why is it we only look at the things of Deen? Now, there is one thing which I saw when I was studying in Pakistan, and this is something which perhaps I will highlight. Leading up to the days of the Udhiyya and the Qurbani, what people would do is that they would push livestock prices through the roof. Cows, sheep, everything would go absolutely through the roof. And people would demand absolutely extravagant amounts of money for things that would cost a fraction of the price in normal days. Alhamdulillah, I salute the people's jazba, their desire, their passion, their want to do something for the sake of Allah, mashallah. But the truth of the matter is, now this has created a very unfair type of supply and demand business where people know that they can rear animals, look after them, and then in the days of Qurbani, whack up the prices and people buy them. What I agree with, the person who mentioned the i'tiraz and the objection, that gather your money, give that to the poor. What I encourage, instead of spending 5 lakh, 2, 20 lakh, 100, 1, like 1 crore, Allahu Akbar, 50 grand on a cow, 50 grand. Instead of spending that much amount of money, do this, get a simple one, maybe cost you 50, 60, 80, maybe even 1 lakh rupees, cost you 400, 500 quid. And the rest of your 99 lakh, which you were going to spend on that massive looking cow, give that to the poor. Go and give 99 people 1 lakh each, or 40 people 2 lakh each. Do you get it? That's what I would encourage, but I wouldn't say don't fulfill the action at all. I'm not saying that. I'm saying don't fall hand to these kind of agricultural farmer mafia that are just put up the massive prices and rob people in the days of Eid al-Adha. But where, unfortunately, people now, it's becoming like a thing where, oh, we spent 20 lakh, I spent 40 lakh, I spent 10 lakh. Now it's become, unfortunately, means of show. Atta ibn Yasar, rahimahullah ta'ala, the hadith goes back there, doesn't it? In Jami al-Tirmidhi, 1505, where he mentioned that people would sacrifice, a man would sacrifice on behalf of himself and his family. And then it got to a stage where what people would then would boast about it. And then it became as you see it now. Sadly, it has become like that, not in all places, but in some places. So to avoid that, I would say do a small qurbani, give the rest of the money in that particular instance. Although those people who are sincere and are doing it solely for Allah and for the sake from their hearts, may Allah accept your qurbani. Now the question arises, how many shares are there in an animal? And I just mentioned it a second ago, that for a sheep, a goat is 1 share, and for a camel and a cow is 7 shares. And this is mentioned in the Sahih of Imam Muslim, rahimahullah ta'ala, hadith number 1318. And you can find a numerous hadith, about 6 hadith there, talking about the shares of the animals. Likewise, similarly as well, if 2 people, it doesn't mean that you have to have 7 people in a cow. Let's just say 2 people want to share a cow, 3 people, 4 people, yani up to 7. So you can have anything up to 7. You can't have more. You can't have 8, 9, or 10, or anything like that. 7 is the limit. And this has been this is the final action which has been established in the deen. Again, Hadith Muslim 1318. If you look there, inshallah, the reference can be found there. What age should the animal be? And on this, the Prophet ﷺ mentions a couple of hadith. Number 1 can be found in Muslim, hadith number 1967, 1963 on the authority of Jabir radiallahu anhu. And the other one, Imam Bukhari 5547. In khulasa, in summary, what do they mention? The hadith, it mentions that the Prophet ﷺ ordered us to slaughter a musinna animal which is an adult. So a camel which has gone to its 5th year, a cow 2 years, a goat 1 year, and a sheep minimum 6 months old. Likewise, the animal should be absolutely free from fault. It shouldn't have no fault. It shouldn't be blind in one eye, not have ears, not be able to step on the feet, for example, not to have a limp, and so on, inshallah. So keep this in mind when looking for an animal and making sure that the animal itself is suitable and appropriate. A masala which arises, well, what if somebody buys an animal and then is able to sell it for a lot more? What do they do? If somebody is able to do that, first of all, it's not permissible to sell an animal at all, only with the intention of buying it, selling it to buy an even better animal. And if, for example, somebody sold an animal for, they bought it for 300 and sold it for 4, you now have to spend that £100 for sadaqah. You cannot keep that money. That money must go to charity, because the animal which was bought, it was initially bought with the intention of the udhiyya. So any money which is earned therefrom should also go into charity as well. All ulama agree, and the hadith also mentions as well that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he slaughtered after the salah for on Eid. Anything before the salah would invalidate it. If somebody were to slaughter an animal before salah, that person's qurbani wouldn't be valid, they'd have to repeat it again. But the question arises is that how many days Eid al-Adha and how many days thereafter? Now there are 2 opinions which exist. One, Eid al-Adha, 10, 11, 12. The other opinion is with an added day to complete the full Ayyam al-Tashriq, because Eid al-Adha is total of 3 days. Ayyam al-Tashriq is an additional day. Now, again, both sides have a hadith, both sides have evidences. One of the opinions that it says, the hadith said, Ayyam al-Tashriq kulluha dhabh. This particular hadith is found in Sunan al-Kubra of Bayhaqi, and you can see that particular hadith there. However, there's one particular narrator in the sanad and the chain of transmission which ulama have spoken about and have some reservations as to whether it's a fully authentic hadith. Another report that can be found, which kind of goes against this particular report. It's found in Mishkat al-Masabih, and it's Isnad al-Sahih, 1418. Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, he mentions that al-adha yawmani ba'da yawm al-adha, that Eid al-adha, it carries on for 2 days after the original or initial adha. So that means 10, 11 and 12. So we have 3 days in total. Now, in all fairness, because of the nature of the ikhtilaf, I think that the Qurbani should be done up until the 12th. And there's a reason behind that, an additional reason as well. Qurbani and Udhiyya is a worship. And Muslims should hasten towards worship. We shouldn't delay worship for whatever reason. We should hasten as much as we can. And for that reason, I think the 12th qawl is more safer and more better. However, even though I don't follow the opinion, I do believe as well that if somebody, due to some majburi, difficulty, some reason, arid, a difficulty, wasn't able to do it, based on the other opinion of those ulama, it would be correct. Again, I mentioned I go with the first opinion, but I'd also am making space for others to appreciate that, yeah, there is ikhtilaf, and two camps have this particular opinion. Now, when it comes to the Qurbani, first of all, it's encouraged to slaughter yourself. Now, look, obviously, we're citizens of the country. We don't encourage anyone to break the law, hygiene, health and safety and so on. So for that, we have a majburi and a difficulty. So that's why we can get ours done via the abattoirs, through a butchering service and so on. There's also another option as well, is that, or the question arises, can you do Qurbani and Udhiyya in another country? Now, look, transferring meat to another country, some ulama have said it's disliked and makruh. However, contemporary ulama agree that it is absolutely no issue at all. So if somebody wanted to do an Udhiyya and a Qurbani in another country, absolutely no problem. And I personally feel this is a very, very good opinion. I feel that giving our Qurbani abroad in another country would be more beneficial for the ghuraba and the masakin and the poor, because it would help those individuals, give them food which they have not eaten perhaps a whole year. I was listening to one scholar, subhanAllah, and he mentioned that when we were younger, we only could ever eat meat on Eid al-Adha. We only ever ate meat on Eid al-Adha. The whole year they would be eating pulses and vegetables and so on. Only Eid al-Adha would be the one occasion where they would get meat to eat. Ha, there is a bit of a delicate issue here, and that is that we're supposed to slaughter after the Salah. That just has to be necessary. So let it not be that any butchering service is like someone, like there's Eid Salah, some people do it really late, 11 o'clock. But what if your animal was slaughtered at 8 o'clock? Well, that's a fiqhi issue. So you should really be in touch with the butchers and ask them, roughly what time do you slaughter, and pray your salah beforehand. That is obviously the more safer bet. If somebody is doing it in another country, for example, in a different time zone where they're ahead, then inshallah you pray your salah, and that will be, you'll be free from any obscurity or any issues, or perhaps doing it in a time which affects your salah. However, how do you distribute? Now, again, all these things I'm mentioning, you'll find evidences and narration from this as well. And it mentions that you can distribute it in any way, shape or form you like, in any way. So what some fuqaha mention is mustahab to divide the meat into three parts. Keep one for yourself, you know, to cook, eat on the day, eat from some of the meat. And also I'll mention this as well. It was the noble act of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to also eat in the meat as well. Another one is to distribute amongst, you know, friends, family, relative, ahbab, nearby. And then third one, to give to the fuqara and masakin. This is not a hard and fast rule. You can distribute it any way which you like. You can give it to Muslims, non-Muslims. You can give it to anybody. The point is to give people. Give people. Be open-hearted and give. Right, last maslah. What is the issue of cutting the hair and the nails? Now look, Imam Muslim in hadith number 1977. There's a number of hadith there. The hadith mentions, إِذَا رَأَيْتُمْ هِلَالَ ذِي الْحِجَّةِ وَأَرَادَ أَحَدُكُمْ أَنْ يُضَحِي فَلْيُمْسِكْ عَنْ شَعْرِهِ وَأَظْفَارِ. The hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentions, Umm Salama radiallahu anha, she says that the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِذَا رَأَيْتُمْ هِلَالَ ذِي الْحِجَّةِ, when you see the crescent of the moon of the hijjah, and any one of you intends to make the qurbani and the udhiyya, they should not take their sha'r, their hair, and they should not take anything from their nails. Yani cut hair and nails, it shouldn't be done. Wording of this hadith can be found in a number of different hadith. Point is, it's absolutely sahih and authentic. However, you do have, I'll be honest and say, a lot of ulama, majority say that you should not take nails and hair and so on. And you do have some ulama of the opinion that no, this was a hukum which was more of a preferred an istihbabi recommendation, not really a fard and wajib. But what is the philosophy and the reason behind the reason for not cutting hair or nail? It's simply just to resemble the hujjaj. Those people that have gone for hajj, is to simply resemble them. Like how when you're in ihram, you don't cut nails, you don't apply perfume, you don't cut the hair, and so on, many different things. Once the qurbani has been done, then mashallah, you can make qurbani of your nails and your hair as well, no problem, according to the first group of ulama. I want to raise one last thing. And that is that unfortunately, due to some people's negligence on how they're doing the udhiyya and sacrifice, it's given a very, very bad press to Islam. And that is because they have not followed the proper prophetic manner and the rules which had been laid down by the jurists based on Quran and Hadith. Number one, when the udhiyya is done, it should be done swiftly. It should be done very quickly. And it should be done with the least taklif given to the animal as possible. Number two, the knife should be absolutely sharp so it's not blunt to cause unnecessary stress. Number three, the animal should not be taken where they can see that there are other animals around that has been slaughtered. This is something which has been considered, disliked, and very much argued against by the fuqaha and the jurists. You know, unfortunately, you have a lot of bogus people on the day of Eid going around masquerading as butchers and people that can do the qurbani, and they do mad blunders. And as a result, these things get uploaded online and unfortunately it gets a negative light. I mean, I know we can argue and people can say, well, hold on a second. You have these big multinational corporations that are slaughtering animals within the hundreds and thousands on a daily basis to put more money in fat cats' pockets, which are already fat. And here we have money which has been or spent for an animal to be given to the poor. I mean, the whole world is in frenzy about that, but not about the multinational corporations. You know, so please, before we give bad name to Islam, or before we ourselves also are an instrument to cause more of a down name calling towards Islam, we should follow the prophetic sunnah in every way which we possibly can. I'm going to leave it here, inshallah, because much has been said. May Allah Ta'ala give us the tawfiq and the ability to practice on the good which has been mentioned, and inshallah include me in your du'as in the coming days. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.